Well, hello, church family and friends, and welcome to Maple Ridge CRC Online this week. We are excited to be joining with you wherever you're watching from. And we only have one quick announcement, a relational one, and that's to celebrate and to wish Headley Stell a happy birthday this week. We're thankful for Alexis, who's asked if we could announce it. So thank you, Mrs. Stell, for reminding me of that. And Headley, we pray and hope and celebrate your birthday and that you would have a blessed day, a blessed year, and for health and happiness and wholeness and God's love to shine upon you. And so, Headley, we're thankful that you're part of this community and know that we love you. So happy birthday. As we lead into worship, the topic for today is love. And I thought of two portions of scripture that might connect well with later. And that is found in Psalm 34, verse 8, which says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is he who takes refuge in him." Blessed is he who takes refuge in him. Would we taste and see that God is good? Would we taste and see that he is with us? And would we take refuge in him as blessed men and women, sons and daughters of a holy God? And then in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." Would we remember what he's done, that he so loves us, and our response is to love him and to love people? And in this time, would we taste and see that he is good, that what he did for us was good, that he is a good God, and that he is with us, that he loves us? Let's pray. God, we thank you for the cross. We thank you that we call you Father, that we call you God and Savior, and we bless you, Lord. Would you hear the praises of your people as we worship today? We pray this in your name. Amen. Let's worship a good God. Let's taste and see that he is good. Amen.
Thank you. is love, vast as the ocean, loving kindness as the flood. When the Prince of Life, our ransom, shed for us his precious blood. Who is love will not remember, who can cease to sing his praise? He can never be forgotten throughout heaven's eternal days. On the Mount of Crucifixion, fountains open deep and wide. Through the flood gates of God's mercy flowed a vast and gracious tide. Grace and love like mighty rivers poured incessant from above, and hymns, peace and perfect justice kissed a guilty world in love. In thy truth thou dost direct me, by thy Spirit through thy word, and thy grace my need is meeting, as I trust in thee, my Lord. Of thy fullness thou art pouring thy great love and power on me, without measure, full and boundless, drawing out my heart to thee.
So as we transition into a time of prayer, what I'd like to do is just to encourage our church family and friends this week, as I wear this poppy over my heart, as you see it on this cross, would we remember? Would we remember the sacrifices that were made? Would we remember for those who have served? Would we remember what God's done for us? Amen. I'm going to invite Kathy Smith to come up and to lead us in intercessory prayer.
Hi, everyone. Last week's Sunday was the International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church. And as unbelievable as it may seem to us, living here in relative comfort and safety, over 245 million Christians are persecuted for their faith around the world. And one of the resources that I go to on an almost daily basis is an app on my phone, which is put out by Open Doors. It's called Pray for the Persecuted Church. So if you would like more information on how to pray and on prayer requests, for example, one came in today indicating that in India, 80 to 90% of those who receive aid from Open Doors partners were denied official aid because they follow Christ. So you get these notifications, you get stories of people who are persecuted, and then specific prayer requests. So if you're interested, it's called Pray for the Persecuted Church. And I actually have used the last four prayer requests that have come through to help form my prayer today. So having said all that, my prayer today will focus on praying for the persecuted church. And so I invite you to join me now. Father, in 2 Corinthians 10, verses 3 to 4, we learn that though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. Our prayers are those weapons, and we ask that you would hear our prayers today. During this pandemic, we pray for Christians suffering from extreme persecution and COVID-19. We ask that you would provide much needed aid and relief to our desperate brothers and sisters who are impacted by both the global crisis and daily persecution, many of whom are denied government relief because they are Christians. Lord, hear our prayer. God of all grace, we pray for Christians under government surveillance and targeted by ultra-nationalists in countries like China and India. We ask that you would give church leaders and Christians wisdom and courage in the face of opposition to gather and to spread the gospel. We particularly pray for Pastor Badal Day and his wife Isona from Bangladesh, who on October 18 were badly beaten after a gang of 25 people came to their home. Ignoring their pleas for mercy, the gang then set their house on fire along with a church building next door. Badal and Isona are currently living on a tent in their property. Father, we pray for the safety and protection of this family as they do not have any other place to go and are fearful there could be another attack. We pray that neighboring believers, especially their church members, would offer practical help and encouragement to them. And we pray that the local police would take proper action against the perpetrators and help pursue justice for Pastor Badal. Lord, hear our prayer. God of all mercy, we pray for Christians under the threat of Muslim extremism. We ask that you would give believers in the Middle East and other areas dominated by extremist strains of Islam strength and hope as they follow Jesus in such difficult and dangerous situations. In particular, we pray for the villagers of Beedi and Lisasa in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. On October 28, members of the Allied Democratic Forces attacked these villages, killed 39 people, and destroyed a church building. We pray for protection and provision for those Christians who have been displaced by these actions. Would you protect them from further attacks and provide for their physical, medical, and emotional needs? Comfort those who are mourning and provide families for those who have lost their own. And we pray for pastors that they would have wisdom and strength as they minister in these uncertain and very dangerous circumstances. Give them courage and strength by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, hear our prayer. God of all hope, we pray for Christians under attack and threatened with violence. We ask you would protect Christians in some of the most dangerous countries to follow Jesus today, like Nigeria, North Korea, Afghanistan, and Somalia. In particular, we pray for two families in southern Laos. On October 10, at least two local officials, several military soldiers, and some locals destroyed the home and property of one family and barricaded the home of another family so they cannot enter. Currently, these believers are taking temporary shelter in the forest. We pray for your provision and protection for those believers who have lost their homes. Thank you that Open Doors local partners have been able to provide the families with rice, clothes, blankets, and other necessities. We pray these families will find refuge and comfort in you despite losing their homes and the trauma the incident may have brought. We pray that you will change the hearts of their persecutors and cause them to follow Christ. And we pray these believers will not waver in their faith, but will continue to be living testaments of God in their area. Lord, hear our prayer. God of all love, show us how we can be your hands and feet of provision to these our brothers and sisters in need. May they be encouraged in knowing that we are praying for them and advocating on their behalf. Bless organizations like Open Doors and Voice of the Martyrs with financial resources and the ability to reach the most vulnerable. We pray all this in the name of the Father, who loves us with a love that is unending. May our persecuted brothers and sisters know that love, Lord, and be filled to the measure of all fullness in you. We pray this in the name of Jesus, who gave his life that they might live and have life everlasting. And we pray this in the name of the Holy Spirit, whose presence guides, consoles, and empowers. Amen.
Well, good morning, church family. It's good to worship together this morning online. We come now to our time in God's Word. We're continuing to reflect together on the series Reset, continuing to wonder together around these areas of our lives in which God may, through all that's going on, God may in fact be inviting us to hit the reset button, to reset priorities, to reset perspectives, to reset habits and ways in which we are prioritizing things in our life, the things that matter the most to us. This morning, we want to reflect together on what a reset in the area of Christian love might look like. Our passage this morning, we're just continuing where we left off last week, 1 Peter. We're in chapter 1, verse 22, through chapter 2, verse 3. Let me read it for us. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for your brothers, love one another deeply from the heart. For you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God. For all men are like grass, and their glory is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of the Lord stands forever. And this is the word that was preached to you. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you've tasted that the Lord is good. This is God's word for us this morning. And there are two things here that I want to highlight about Christian love. The first is this, and that it has to do with the centrality of Christian love, the centrality of Christian love. Now, the structure here in verses 22 and 23, they help us see that this call to Christian love, to love one another deeply from the heart, is how Peter puts it here, that this call is grounded in two realities of the Christian life. And in other words, Peter is saying in two different ways, because this is true, therefore love one another deeply from the heart. In light of this, love one another deeply from the heart. What is the first grounding? It's the gospel. He puts it this way, now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth. And this word here, purified, it's the word consecrated, to be set apart. We've been set apart, you might put it, by taking hold of the gospel as true. And in taking hold of the gospel as true, that act of obedience and taking hold of that truth has set us apart. And we've been looking throughout this letter so far at different facets of that gospel truth. This new birth, the living hope that we have, this future inheritance that's secure, the shielding of God's power that holds us fast, keeps us to the end, the blood of Christ that has been poured out to purchase our redemption, to deliver us from an empty way of life, of the future grace that is ours in Christ. And if we believe this gospel to be true, if we take hold of the gospel and God's grace that comes to us in the gospel, there ought to be a change of life. See, taking hold of the gospel is true is much richer and fuller than just intellectual assent to a bunch of ideas. It's not less than that, but it's much more. It leads to a changed life. And quite frankly, loving other people, love for others is so central to the gospel, Peter's saying. So now that you've taken hold of this gospel, now that you've been set apart by believing in the truth of the gospel, love one another deeply from the heart. We could actually think about it this way. Loving others well is really an acid test, if you will, that the gospel has in fact changed us and that the gospel is something that we're taking hold of. What do I mean by an acid test? Well, this phrase acid test has come to mean this. It's the way of proving the value of something or the standard that something must meet in order to prove its value, its authenticity, its genuineness. So how do you know that you've taken hold of the gospel truth? How do you know that the gospel is alive and changing you? How do you know that? One of the ways you can know that is whether or not you are growing in love, in Christian love for other people. Let's think about this for a few moments, and let's just take one facet of this gospel. The facet that tells us that we are saved by God's grace. Grace alone, by faith alone. Not on the basis of our own religious or moral performance, but simply because of God's grace. That's undeserved. Now, if that's not growing in you, if on the ground in terms of the way you live your life, if it would seem that you live in a way that would suggest you might believe that you're really saved by your performance and by your goodness, not by grace, that will likely become evident because you'll develop one of two different dispositions towards other people. On the one hand, you might become someone who's smug, who's self-assured, self-righteous, demanding and cold, even critical towards other people, especially those who don't measure up to your standards, who do you wrong, who do other people wrong, who hurt others. People like that you will tend to reject or at least be cold to or at least look down at and become smug towards. You're confident that you're doing a pretty good job in your own moral performance, that you're a pretty good person. And what's with these other people who just don't cut it? If that describes your disposition towards other people, let me suggest to you that it may suggest that you are not living as one who has been saved by grace, that you're not really taking hold of the truth of the gospel, the truth that says you're saved by grace alone. What do you mean those people don't cut it? You don't cut it. Or, it could look very differently, you might become someone who's defensive, who's easily slighted, who's insecure, a bit prickly. You're closed, you're cut off from other people. You don't want to be vulnerable. You have a deep insecurity about your own worth. It's easier to avoid other people. Better, in fact, you reason, than feeling judged or being reminded that you don't quite measure up. You know you're not doing a good job at your performance. You know you don't quite cut it. And if this is what shapes your interaction with other people, it's, again, a sign that you're not really living as one who's been saved by grace. None of us cut it. It's only the grace of God that comes to us in the gospel that can both humble us, reminding us again and again that we are sinners saved only by grace, not our performance. None of us ever make the cut. As we receive that grace, we're so much more likely to extend that grace to others who, just like us, don't quite measure up. And it's only the grace of God that comes to us in the gospel that at the same time can assure us that we are more loved and we are more cherished than we will ever be able to imagine. There's absolutely no reason to hang our heads low. The King of the universe delights in you. If you've taken hold of the gospel, the King of the universe, the Creator God, delights in you. There's no reason to hang your head low. You are loved. You are accepted. You are delighted in and cherished. It's only the gospel that can do both of those things at the same time. And when your heart grabs hold of these truths, it becomes so much more natural to love other people well. Reflect on these questions with me. These are questions drawn from another pastor who was reflecting on these verses. And I quote, "Do you find yourself forgiving? Do you naturally forgive people? Do you find yourself being positive to people who are criticizing you? Do you find yourself being able to affirm people even as they're harming you? Do you find yourself being able to continue to pull for the success of people who've wronged you and harmed you? Do you find yourself being gracious and open and vulnerable in the way you deal with people, in your manner and in your face and in your tone of voice and in your comments, so people want to come and tell you and share with you their struggles as well? Or are you peevish? Are you touchy? Are you sensitive to criticism? Are you always feeling like people are slighting you? Are you cold, unapproachable? Are you smug and sneering? Are you self-righteous?" My friends, this is one of the ways you know whether or not you believe the gospel. You see, loving others is central to the gospel. And Christian love is grounded in a second reality we see. Peter goes on to say, "For you have been born again, and of perishable seed." Sorry, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God. And notice what Peter's saying here. God's word is power. God's word is power to change lives, power to generate new spiritual life, being reborn. The life of a Christian is a life that has been regenerated by the seed of God's powerful and enduring word that's been planted, that's taken root, that's growing and producing a harvest. And so Christian love, to love one another deeply from the heart, is a defining quality of this new spiritual life that's been birthed in us by the word of God. It's a new kind of life, and it's a new life that at its root has love. And this is the case because it's nothing less than the life of God that's been birthed in us. 1 John 4 puts this so beautifully. Let me read from it. "Let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. And this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. And since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. God is love. And whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in him." So let me ask you, if these things are true, if Christian love is central, let me ask you, would love for other people be a defining central quality of your life? Imagine with me if the people around you were asked, people that knew you well, if they were asked to describe you, if they were asked to highlight what stands out about you, would they say, among other things, would they say, You know what stands out? It's the way that she loves other people. Would they mention that? Can you begin to hear God's invitation for a reset in this area of our lives? The second thing I want to talk about this morning, reflect with you on, is the character of Christian love. We've seen the centrality of Christian love. Let's talk about the character of Christian love. And notice first with me, the invitation, I've mentioned it a number of times, but it's to love deeply from the heart, from the core of our being. this word deeply. It's a striking word, in fact. It's a word that's taken from the world of athletics. And in particular, it's taken from the realm of long-distance running and competition. And the sense of this word is this, is to exert yourself strenuously with all of your energy. Begin to put that together. The character of Christian love requires effort. A great amount of effort. It's strenuous love. It's love that doesn't give up easily. It's love that's a stick with it love, that I'm going to be with you, and I'm going to walk with you no matter what happens. A love that goes the distance, even when it's hard, even when it's not reciprocated. It's what it looks like to love deeply. But then notice, secondly, and here's where I want to spend more time as we close. It's a love that requires us to engage in what we might call a ridding process. Let me reread verse 2 of chapter 2. Actually, sorry, verse 1. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Rid yourselves. Get rid of, discard, put away, stop. Might we even say, reset. Notice what we're to be rid of. Each of these words points to specific ways. Each of these words is relational, and they point to specific ways that, and specific character traits almost, that damage and destroy relationships and community. We're to get rid of this stuff. Let's look at them in turn. First, we're to be rid of all malice. Peter writes, it's the most general of the terms that are used here, and it's a term that really means the opposite of virtue. The opposite of virtue in the Greco-Roman world of the New Testament, virtue and personal virtues were prized. In fact, it was part of Greco-Roman culture that was being spread throughout the empire at the time, were different virtues, and among those virtues, there were some that were elevated above others. Virtues like wisdom and courage and moderation and justice. And this word, all malice, essentially means the lack of all virtue. It's a catch-all sort of phrase for any number of character defects that might harm our relationships. And as I was thinking about that this week, I couldn't help but think of this card. And some of you are going to recognize this card. For those that don't, this card says defects of character. It comes from one of the ministries of our church, Freedom Session, a discipleship healing ministry. And the idea at some point in the journey is that you take this card that lists, my goodness, lots of defects of character, and that you hand it to someone that knows you well. And you say to that person, you know, I'm working hard to identify defects in my character. I wanna love others well and get better at it. Could you circle the defects of character you see in me? Could you be honest and help me in that way? I remember the first time I was in the course that we were asked to do this, and I thought, like, are you crazy? Really? Yeah, really. And you know, it was hard. It really was hard to give this to people and say, could you be honest with me? But I can sit here and tell you that it was well worth it to allow people that cared enough about me to say, you know, I see this defect in you, and it comes out in this way. And help me identify things that I could work on, things that I could get rid of, right? Because it takes strenuous effort. It takes great effort to get rid of these things. How about you? Would you be willing to put in the effort to get rid of the defects of character in your life that are tripping you up in your relationships? Get rid of all malice. Secondly, get rid of all deceit. Deceiving others, lying, not representing yourself or a situation accurately, either by making the situation or yourself appear worse or better than it actually was. We could go on. We could think of many ways that deceit creeps into our relationships, our conversations, and the way it begins to destroy those things. And one of the reasons that deceit does this is deceit over time erodes trust. Trust is like a foundation on which healthy relationships get built. And without a foundation of trust, relationships get really wobbly really quick. How honest are you in your relationships right now? You know, I think one of the unique opportunities that we have right now to strengthen our love and to strengthen our relationships with each other is through honesty and vulnerability. We're all living through a really hard time, a difficult time, facing so much uncertainty, so much instability and chaos, and so many unknowns, and so many limitations and disruptions, so much grief and loss. What might it look like during this time for us to be the kind of people that would create space for others and hold that space open so that they could share honestly that life is hard right now? And when life is hard, would we be the kind of people that would rid ourselves of the deceit that tries to pretend that it's not hard? Would we be the kind of people that could say with honesty and vulnerability, it's okay to not be okay? Christian love is truthful, it's honest, it even risks vulnerability. So would we rid ourselves of deceit? Third, rid yourselves of hypocrisy. And this word hypocrisy, it's a particular kind of deceit, really. It's pretending to be one way or one kind of person and then turning around and acting in a totally different way. Talking behind someone's back, being two-faced, gossiping. There's lots of ways that hypocrisy can express itself in our relationships. But let me also speak into another way that's popping up right now that really troubles me. I mentioned it briefly last week. I want to speak into it a bit more. A fundamental quality of Christian love. It's been true throughout the centuries. Following the love of Christ, our Messiah, our King, is a love that's selfless. A love that looks to the good of others. A love that's even willing to sacrifice my good and my comfort for the well-being and the good of those around me. And one of the most fundamental ways that we're being asked to do that right now, during this pandemic, is to protect other people from the spread of this pandemic. To put on a mask. Not for your sake. The masks were never about you, but for the sake of your neighbor. To keep your droplets to yourself. To keep your distance from those who aren't in your bubble. To respect physical distancing with others. To stay home when you're not feeling well. You know, Dr. Henry has been gentle and yet firm on very practical ways that we can be kind and show love to one another during this time. Church, it would seem to me, and help me if I'm not seeing it right, but it would seem to me to be a significant form of hypocrisy if Christians were not leading the way in making sacrifices for the good of those around us. Rid yourselves of all hypocrisy. Rid yourselves of envy. Envy really disrupts love. And instead of desiring what's best for other people, envy often either wishes for their downfall or at least your promotion and your well-being over theirs. Whether it's their position in life, whether it's the type of holidays that they take, whether it's the kind of home they live in, the human heart is prone, very prone, to envy what others have and we don't. And envy is profoundly self-focused, feeding discontentment, feeding jealousy. Let me ask you, where are you tempted towards envy right now? And how is your envy exposing the discontent of your heart? Would you rid yourselves of envy? And finally, as we close, rid yourselves of slander of every kind. Slander of every kind. You know, slander can be overt. You put other people down, you call them names, you spread lies that tear them down, you make fun of them, you call them names, and it can be very obvious, and yet slander can also be very covert as well, very subtle. You put someone in a box, for example, and then you never expect them to be anyone but the box that you've put them in. And as I've been reflecting on this, it would seem to me that this would be a particular temptation in a community like ours, wouldn't it? I mean, so many of us have known each other for so long. Oh, you know so-and-so. That's how so-and-so is. And besides, they come from that family, and that's how that family has been. And before you know it, we've got a box with all the different family names of this church on it. And we put people in those boxes, not giving them a chance to break out of that box, making judgments about them based on our past experiences with them. And then even more dangerous, beginning to close off our hearts towards them, no longer caring or being concerned. Would we rid ourselves of slander of every kind, things that would contaminate our Christian love? So let me ask you, as we close, can you begin to hear God's invitation to reset our Christian love? We've embedded this in our vision, that we would love God, that we would love our city, that we would grow in love for one another. The heart of the kind of community that we feel God is calling us to be. We grow in this Christian love for one another. So let me ask you, can you think of people that you need to renew and reset your love for in this community? People perhaps for whom your love has grown cold, and perhaps for some of the very reasons that we've talked about this morning. And if God's Spirit would give you those names, I invite you to pray and to ask the Holy Spirit to rid your heart of that coldness, the things that would hinder you from loving each other deeply with strenuous effort from the heart. This is the call. This is the invitation. And I'm convinced that it would be a powerful witness to the gospel for Christian communities to become known once again as communities of people that love each other deeply from the heart. You know, the world has seen enough hatred, enough division, enough name-calling, enough slurring and slandering, enough fighting, enough. It's ripping our societies and our families apart. What a breath of fresh air it would be for the church to rise up as it has throughout history in times like this and be known once again as a community that loves other people deeply from the heart. May it be so here, friends, to the glory of God and to the advancement of His kingdom. Amen. Let's pray. God, we thank You for Your word this morning. We thank You for this invitation to love each other deeply from the heart. As we imagine what a reset in this area would look like for us, Holy Spirit, would You speak to us? Would You reveal to us the things that we need to rid ourselves of? If there are people that we've grown cold towards, God, would You renew our warmth and our love for them? Would you move us to action, to tangible ways to reach out in love towards them? God, we want your gospel to be at the center of our hearts and lives, to continually change us and humble us and amaze us with your love, that we might be a people who've experienced so much grace that that grace can't help but seep out towards those around us. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. As we draw our time to a close, I invite you to linger for a final song of worship, and before that, receive the Lord's blessing. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, the fellowship of the presence of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen. Be blessed.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name.